We've all heard of El Niño and La Niña, haven't we? The powerful swings in Pacific Ocean temperatures that drive droughts, floods, hurricanes and bushfires in countries all over the planet. If you watch this channel regularly, you may even have seen the various videos I've made on the subject over the years. This so-called El Niño-Southern Oscillation, or ENSO system, swings back and forth, usually over the course of several years, but never in a particularly predictable way. That means everyone from farmers and builders to policymakers and insurers just have to kind of suck it up when a strong El Niño or La Niña impacts them adversely in any given year. Until now, those impacts have been costly and extremely frustrating, but not usually at a level that represents an existential risk to businesses and livelihoods. And because you know me fairly well by now, I'm sure you can guess what I'm going to say next. Yes, folks, recent research is now suggesting we may only have been watching the warm-up act. And to borrow a line from the Joker's unhinged forerunner, Jerome, in the TV series Gotham...
Hang on to your hats, folks, because you ain't seen nothing yet!
Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. There's actually been a couple of peer-reviewed research papers published in the last couple of months, each addressing a different but equally important aspect of the way our rapidly warming climate is impacting the ENSO system. The latest paper, published in Nature Communications, suggests the system could be shifting into a higher gear, with all sorts of very unwelcome implications. If the author's findings prove to be accurate, then the Pacific Ocean may be about to start resonating like a giant tuning fork, sending stronger, more rhythmic climate shockwaves around the globe. Before we get to that though, let's have a quick recap on how the ENSO system works. Under normal conditions, trade winds blow warm surface waters westward across the South Pacific, piling up heat near Indonesia and Australia, while cooler waters well up near South America. Every few years, those winds drop off a bit, allowing the warm water to move back east with a bunch of corresponding atmospheric responses. That's what the meteorologists call the El Niño phase. The Pacific flips into a warmer, wetter regime that rearranges rainfall and temperature patterns across half the planet. Then at some random future point, anywhere between a few months and a few years later, the winds roar back, cold water surges upwards, and we get La Niña, which generally has a cooling effect on atmospheric temperatures. This oceanic seesaw is the world's single most influential climate rhythm. It can make or break growing seasons from Argentina to India and flip rainfall patterns across Africa and North America. But crucially, it's always been irregular, sometimes a strong swing, sometimes barely noticeable, and never quite on schedule. And that irregularity has actually been our saving grace in a way, because it tends to spread out the extremes over time, giving everyone a chance to recover and get back on track. This new research, led by climate scientists from China, the US and Europe, used high-resolution climate models to test how the system behaves as global average temperatures climb. And here's what they found. As the background heat rises, the Pacific's feedback loops of interactions between ocean currents, wind patterns and surface temperatures start to line up in sync. The whole system finds a resonant mode. In other words, the ocean and atmosphere start reinforcing each other at a regular interval instead of wobbling randomly like they do at the moment. But a more predictable system is surely easier to deal with than a random one, right? Well, not so much. It might be more regular, but it'll also be more powerful, according to the authors of this paper. Each cycle injects huge pulses of heat and moisture into the atmosphere, which then ripple through jet streams, monsoon systems and storm tracks all around the world. So when ENSO starts to resonate, the energy in those ripples increases too. That means bigger droughts, heavier downpours, more intense cyclones, all following a stronger and more reliable beat. In practical terms, that could mean multiple breadbasket regions like the US Midwest, South America and Southeast Asia being hit by concurrent climate shocks. And that's before we even layer on the trade disruptions and geopolitical knock-ons that would follow as a result. While those scientists were uncovering that slightly disturbing dynamic, another team down in Australia was working on a different but entirely related problem, namely how to measure each swing in the ENSO system in a meaningful and useful way, given how significantly our baseline average atmospheric temperature has risen in recent years. Traditionally, meteorologists have used something called the Niño 3.4 index, which is a kind of temperature gauge for a big patch of the central tropical Pacific. If that region warms by half a degree or more for several months, the scientists call it an El Niño event, and if it cools, then it's a La Niña. Nice and simple, nice and clear, and works beautifully in a stable climate. But the climate isn't stable anymore, is it? It's all gone a bit wonky thanks to our greenhouse gas emissions. The entire Pacific Ocean has been quietly warming for decades as those greenhouse gases trap more heat in the system. So what meteorologists have previously taken as an average temperature to compare against, the baseline that defines what's normal, if you like, well, that baseline has been drifting upward. That means a patch of water that would have screamed El Niño 50 years ago might now look perfectly ordinary against an entire ocean background that's shifted upwards in temperature. So Australia's Bureau of Meteorology decided to fix that increasingly noticeable calibration anomaly with a new measuring system that they call the Relative Niño Index. It's a subtle tweak with some pretty big implications. Instead of comparing today's sea surface temperatures to what was the average in the 20th century, the new method compares them to what's normal right now. In other words, it strips out that long-term background warming trend and asks how unusual are these conditions relative to the current climate. That gives scientists a much cleaner signal of whether the Pacific is genuinely swinging into an El Niño or a La Niña phase, or whether it's just sitting in the new warmer normal. If ENSO events themselves become stronger and more rhythmic, then the stakes get even higher for agriculture and food security. Let's take the now very well publicised situation with soybeans, for example. US farmers are already under enormous financial stress as the Trump tariffs forced China to shift its soybean imports towards Brazil and Argentina, leaving American growers with shrinking export demand and thinner margins. At the same time, El Niño events can alter rainfall and temperature patterns across both continents in opposite ways. South American crops tend to take a hit from droughts during strong El Niños, while the US Midwest can face excessive heat and erratic rainfall. A synchronised, more intense ENSO pattern could therefore squeeze production in multiple key regions at once, amplifying market volatility and pushing food prices higher worldwide. Our climate isn't just a set of independent pieces, it's more like a tightly coupled orchestra where each instrument influences the others. Warming the planet isn't just turning up the metaphorical volume, it's changing the tune itself. And the ENSO system sits right at the heart of that change. It interacts with other global systems like the Indian Ocean Dipole, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, and the global monsoons. The implication from this research paper is that if ENSO starts to resonate, it could pull those other systems into rhythm as well, synchronizing droughts and floods that used to occur at different times and places. Everything, everywhere, all at once is definitely not a phrase you ever want to apply to the consequences of a warming climate, but that's where we're heading towards on our current trajectory, and that will be a bit tricky for our kids and grandkids, to say the least. The next step for scientists is to see whether real-world observations start to match the resonance predicted by these models. If they do, then we'll know for sure that El Niño and La Niña are no longer fixed background rhythms. They're a living part of a rapidly evolving climate system. More predictable, yes. Comfortable to live with? Not so much. As always, leave your thoughts in the comment section below. But that's it for this week. If you found this video useful and informative, and you know, not too depressing, then you can really help us out by hitting the like and subscribe buttons on YouTube if you haven't already done so. It's a simple click that costs you absolutely nothing at all, but it really makes a difference to the channel's growth. So if you feel I've earned it this week, then I'd be extremely grateful. You can also directly support my work by joining the fabulous group of individuals over at patreon.com/justhaveathink, who literally keep the lights on around here and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of all my videos. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who've joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Esther Vickers, Richard Stevens, Ray Miller, Paul Norberg, Richard Thompson, William Templeton, Rex Walton, and Giles Goldsborough. And of course, a massive thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.